There is a place that is spoken about only in whispers. A dark area that spawns the beginnings of urban legends. A place where anything can happen and usually does. During the light of day, it hides just outside of view. But when the sun goes down, spirits, creatures of the night, roam free, and things do go bump in the night. It is in every state and every country, and there is no escaping it, no matter how safe you feel behind your locked doors and latched windows. So we invite you to turn down the lights and turn up your radio while we join Dave Schrader and Tim Dennis, your hosts, on a journey into the darkness on the edge of town.
Well, good morning, or good evening, everybody, and good morning, evening. It's middle of the night in New York, so it's good morning. You're welcome back to the second hour of Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. I'd like to thank everybody for tuning in and staying up with us this evening. Tim and I, again, we're out in Colorado doing the live investigation of the Stanley Hotel, and appreciate all you guys tuning in for the new show anyway. As we promised, we're going to deliver a new show for the next couple of weeks. Even though we won't be here live, we will have these brand new shows for you to listen to. We're going to do a follow-up to our first guest, talking about Bigfoot. We've got with us Sally Sheppard Wolford, and she's the author of a series of children's books, including one that explains Bigfoot. She has, this being her first book for adults, she's written a book called Valley of the Skookum, and I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, Sally. It's Valley of the Skookum, is that right?
Yes.
Okay, great. She's released this book, and basically it's kind of an account that she wrote for her daughter, Autumn Williams, who we had on the show a couple months back, describing the events when Autumn was growing up in Washington between the ages of 4 and 7 with the experiences that they were having. And at that time, of course, Autumn had talked to us about her mom and the book and her own experiences, so we wanted to have Sally on the show and actually share them firsthand accounts and talk. She's got a pretty fascinating life with a bunch of different investigative possibilities to talk about here besides just Bigfoot. It seems like you've got quite a bit of interest in the paranormal overall, Sally.
For most of my life, Dave. And thanks for having me on the show.
Oh, well, we appreciate having you here. I'm glad you could join us. Now, let's talk a little bit about this. You said that you've been involved in the paranormal most of your life. What kind of got you kicked off and involved in the paranormal?
My own abilities to begin with.
Okay, and why don't you describe to us what your abilities are?
Well, they're not much these days, but after we lived in Ording, it ended on a rather sad note with friends parting and everything, and I put all of that away for over 20 years. I wouldn't even talk about it.
Wow, okay.
Autumn had to go elsewhere to start her career.
Sure. Sure. So you, but what kind of abilities did you have? Were you mediumistic, psychic? Explain to us a little bit about what kind of abilities you have.
Kind of psychometry stuff. I don't really know the terms.
Sure. But psychometry, of course, being like if you take somebody's personal possession and hold on to it, you can visualize or get energy off of it and an understanding about the person. Is that
yes.
right? Okay. All right. And how old were you when you realized that you had those abilities?
Oh, about 8 or 9.
Oh, really? And do they come to you in flashes? Were they coming to you in solid, sensical, you know, notions? I mean, how exactly were they coming through to you?
I would just know things about people, and my mom and dad and everybody else thought I was kind of screwy. You know, kids aren't accepted. I came from a very religious family.
Sure. It seems funny almost. I mean, most of the people that we have on our show that develop these kind of abilities seem to all come from really religious families. And it just seems so funny to me that it would be people would be gifted like that in these religious families where it's not accepted at all. I mean, it almost seems like a strange little twist of irony God would play on us for doing something like that.
Yeah. Well, my mom has some of those abilities too. She sees auras around people.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So I don't, but
now, you began with those kind of things. When did you, now, I know this book talks about the times between when Autumn was 4 and 7 and the dealings that you had with a Bigfoot. Did you have any other dealings prior to that in your personal life before Autumn was a part of the picture?
You mean as far as Bigfoot?
Right.
No.
No, okay.
I had heard about it.
Sure.
And later on, it turns out many of the places that I lived, there were sightings. But it wasn't anything I was really interested in.
Okay, so it just never really kind of came into your world until that time when Autumn was about 4 years old and you started being visited, right?
That's right.
All right, well, why don't we start off with that then? Now, you were living in Orting, Washington, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where is that on the map so we can kind of get a feel for it?
It's down at the kind of the western base of Mount Rainier.
Oh, okay.
By Puyallup and Tacoma.
Okay. So... Now, explain to us, I believe Autumn had told us, too, that you guys were kind of living in a cabin, right? You guys, it was like...
It was kind of like a cabin.
Kind of like a cabin.
It was more like a shack.
Okay, all right.
It was the only thing we could afford to own. That's why we bought it.
Sure. All right, so you were out there, and now, was this a community? Were there other homes close by? Were you pretty far set away from everybody else?
We were rather far out, yes. There was a little string of cabins almost, you know,
sure.
Along this deserted road out there. There was a few more houses up and down the road, but I didn't realize how many until we heard dogs barking after we moved in and stuff like that.
Oh, okay. All right. So how soon after you moved into this home did things begin to go crazy for you?
About a week or so.
Really?
Oh. Well, actually, the first day I ever went there.
Really? Why don't you tell us what happened then, yeah.
I was walking down a trail. My husband had, we were looking at the property. We walked out towards the river, and he liked to play these little games where he'd run off and hide in the bushes and scare me.
Oh, sure.
Mm-hmm. Well, he ran off and did that, and on the way back up the path, all of a sudden the woods got really quiet, and I felt like I was being watched. And then I heard all these noises, and pretty soon I was running up the path, and I turned around and looked and saw this dark thing zip into the bushes.
Okay. And now, did you think that was your husband at the time, then, or?
No, not at that time. I knew I was being watched by something.
Now, when you say a dark thing, I mean, were you able to tell size, shape, anything like that? Was it completely hairy? Were you able to see those kind of things?
No, I didn't. At that point, I didn't see much of anything. It was just this large blur that disappeared into the trees.
Okay. Now, by large, was it standing upright? Was
yes.
it running like a dog? But it was standing upright.
No, it was standing upright.
And if you had to guesstimate, how tall would you say it was from what you saw?
When I went back to look, mm-hmm. that's when I realized how big it had been. It was probably 7 feet tall.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, did it move silently?
Yeah.
Okay. So you didn't hear any of the loud thumping or anything like that to know that it was following you. You were just kind of picking up on something was amiss.
Well, the woods got really quiet.
Okay.
And it was just eerie. It was so quiet. There was no birds, no anything.
Now, at this point, is your husband wondering where the hell you are? He's off hiding in a bush somewhere?
I didn't care if he was wondering. I fell flat on the sand trying to get away from this. And finally he came. I could hear him calling. And he came and found me. And he said, "Pew, what's that smell?"
You know, that's funny. That's what my kids always say to me when they find me, too. So it did have that funky, skunky odor that everybody comes. Okay. Now, could you smell it after it took off running? Were you able to smell it right away, or did
just
it...
Just faintly.
Okay. But as you got closer to the area, you could... Was the scent... Now, help us understand this. Is it like a skunk smell? I've heard it referred to in so many different ways. Is it like a skunky smell? Is it a I've heard almost like a rotting meat smell sometimes.
It is as pungent as a skunk smell.
Okay.
But not quite... It's not a skunk smell.
All right.
The closest thing I've ever come to it was when we went to, there was a store in Tacoma
mm-hmm.
that had a gorilla in a cage.
Okay.
And you could smell that in the store.
Oh, really? Okay.
It isn't the same, but it was similar.
All right, so it was very similar to a great ape then.
Yes.
Okay, all right.
But not the same.
But not the same, right.
Uh-uh.
Now, so that was your first experience with this. Now, you've now seen this. This is your first day there, Sally. I mean, were you thinking, oh, crap, what did I get into? Why are we living here? Maybe we should go look for another place?
No, it seemed like, hey, there's a mystery here.
Okay. All right. I respect that. See, Tim and I would have been on the next slow boat to China just to get the hell out of here. We don't claim to be brave men now, Sally. But
I'm not brave either.
But did you feel a sense? I mean, if you had some of the psychic abilities, I mean, were you able to sense? It didn't mean you any harm, apparently, right? Did you feel intimidated or spooked by that? Other than the initial, holy crap, what's that?
Yeah.
Did you get any kind of vibe that you were in any kind of danger at all?
No.
All right. Well, that's good. So then it took off. Now, how soon after that did you start having more experiences with this creature?
Oh, about a week after we moved into the cabin.
All right.
And then Autumn and I she was three, and we were walking down the trail. Like most city people, we forgot to bring firewood.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
Duh. So Autumn and I had to go pick up sticks every day to burn, and we just had a wood cook stove to heat the house.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were walking down this trail behind the house, and we turned a corner, and here were these two things standing back in the shadows. A tall one and a little one.
Really? So you had two of them standing out there? Okay.
Yes, a young one.
And were they... Now, how tall would you say the young one was?
Probably, I don't know, less than half the size of the other one.
Okay, so maybe about 4 or 5 feet tall compared to the...
Yeah, it was a much lighter color.
All right. Now, could you tell any kind of sexuality to these creatures? Were they breasts?
No, I didn't see anything like that.
Okay.
What I remember mostly was the big one's eyes.
All right. Now, what kind of eyes? Can you describe that? If you were able to see eyes, did it look like a great ape's eyes? Did it look humanistic? What were we looking at here?
They looked human.
Really? Okay.
Mm-hmm. They had a look in them of great wisdom.
Now, how far away did you say you were from these two characters?
Maybe 25 at the most, 30 feet away.
And Autumn was there as well, right?
Yeah.
And what... Did your daughter look up and freeze in terror or scream or what happened?
No. I don't even know what she was doing.
Okay.
For the moment.
Again, you were zoned into your own world.
Looking at what I was seeing.
Right.
she jokes nowadays that the way I reacted, it was funny to her because these guys just looked like all the rest of her dad's friends. They were big and hairy.
Oh, okay.
So,
Hell's Angels or Mountain Men? Which one was your friend? Okay. Oh, the hippie days. I got you.
Oh,
all
yes.
Right. So
they just didn't have overalls on.
So that was the only separation. Good, good. So we're not that far removed from Bigfoot after all, Tim.
I don't wear overalls anyways.
Yeah,
so.
Exactly. And Tim has been known to walk around in the forest naked. And he's very hairy, so it's crazy.
Half of my family has been accused of being Bigfoot, so there you go.
See?
All right, so now what did these two do once you spotted them? Did you take off, or did they take off first?
Well, I was wearing a fur coat.
Oh, yes.
No, that's not good.
I had an old fur coat that I wore, and the kids named it Kitty.
Okay.
And as we stood there, I don't know how long this lasted, maybe... 5-10 seconds, I don't know.
And then Bigfoot ran up and threw red paint on you and said, fur is murder, fur is murder, and ran away, right?
Did you stroke the coat and go, this is real Sasquatch right here?
No, as he was standing there, we were just kind of, you know.
Eyeballing each other up, right, yeah.
Yeah, and he cocked his head and looked at me like, what kind of animal are you?
Now, did it make any noises to you at all?
No, no noises.
Now, have they ever made noises that you've heard?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Were you close when they made these noises?
They were. I wasn't.
Okay.
Were
they close in proximity to you?
Yes, outside our bedroom.
Oh, geez.
But this time on the trail, I think I'm beginning to wonder if they don't have the ability to kind of hypnotize.
You know, now I have heard that quite a few times that people believe that, and that may be why people don't remember seeing them as much or just snippets of what they've seen.
After we saw them, when the big one cocked his head, it kind of clicked something in my head, and I realized I needed to get my daughter out of there. My protective instincts kind of kicked in.
Okay. Did you feel that maybe it was going to then approach, or...
No, it was just
mom.
All of a sudden I came back to reality, I guess. And so I turned on him and I said, walk, honey, and don't run. and she turned around and walked back the way we had come, and when I got back to her, I picked her up, and we went back to the house and got in bed, and I didn't remember anything about that day until almost 20 years later, and she didn't either.
And how did you find it out then? Were you going through hypnotherapy, or?
No, we were talking on the phone one day about stuff, which I was trying to avoid at all costs.
Okay.
I didn't want to talk about it, and she said, Mom, do you remember any animals on the trail when I was little that didn't seem right? Mm. And I said, yeah. And pretty soon everything started tumbling out, and we were both crying, and we both remembered what had happened.
All right, so you started talking about this, and you got this stuff going on. Now, I mean, so that was your first big initial standing there staring kind of face to face, and it gets better. I mean, you've had crazy experiences over this four year span, but I can't even fathom the idea of, you know, I mean, for snakes, I don't work well with snakes. I see a snake and I can't move. I just stand there and stare. I can't imagine seeing something 7 foot tall and hairy standing there, you know, 25, 30 feet away from me, or 25, 30 yards away from me, and just, how did you keep your cool on this? I mean, I would think your fight or flight instinct would come, you just grab that daughter gears and be hightailing it out of there.
It was like I couldn't move.
Hmm. So that, again, kicking in with that. Now, could you smell the real pungent smell again?
I don't recall smelling at that time, no.
Okay. Well, and it could have been upwind from you that time, or downwind, right?
I don't know.
So,
I have, after those 4 years, I have more questions than I have answers. So, I can answer what I can and...
Oh, sure.
Yeah, well, some of what I can't.
We're trying to learn with you on this. Overall, we're going to have to take a break here in a minute, but just to kind of set up the listeners for the next segment, how many times over this four-year span did you have contact, either visual or audio contact, with Bigfoot?
I don't have a number.
You think 20, 30 times or less?
Well, counting the audio stuff and everything, probably 20.
Wow.
But the neighbors and the rest of my family, most of them had sightings and things too.
All right. Well, we're going to take a quick break. You're listening to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. Our guest is Sally Sheppard Wolford, and she's the author of a book called Valley of the Skookum, 4 Years of Encounters with Bigfoot. We'll be back with more right after this.
It will keep you on the edge of your seat.
I must have drank me about 15 Dr. Peppers.
I got to pay.
Just don't get any on the floor. Hurry back. There is more to come from the Darkness on the Edge of Town.
For 58 years, Fate has consistently supplied its loyal readership with a broad array of true reports of the strange and unknown. Fate is a factual magazine containing articles by experts in all walks of life, and by others just like you who have something dynamic, significant, and truthful to say. Keep up with the latest on angels and miracles, psychic phenomena, ghosts, UFOs, archaeological hotspots, alternative science, and much, much more. To receive your free Fate magazine, call now at 1-800-728-2730 or visit our website at www.fatemag.com. That's 1-800-728-2730 or www.fatemag.com. What are you waiting for? Your fate awaits.
Are you tired of reading about what couple in Hollywood is breaking up or divorcing? Have you ever wondered where you can find the news that covers the subjects that you are really interested in? I would like to invite you to visit SupernaturalNews.com. Supernatural News uses the latest internet technology to search for the topics we know you will be interested in reading. News of the latest Bigfoot, UFO, or Loch Ness Monster sightings. Read about the latest conspiracy theories and urban legends. Supernatural News, where belief and reality merge.
You hear footsteps and things bumping and banging in the middle of the night. Could it be paranormal activity? Or is it just Dave and Tim raiding your fridge?
Beer.
Strange things happen in the darkness on the edge of town.
And welcome back to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. This evening we're discussing a book called Valley of the Skookum, written by Sally Sheppard Wolford. And it's a four-year account that basically Sally wrote for her daughter, Autumn Williams, to describe the events that had taken place during a four-year span in their life when they were having Bigfoot encounters. It's a four-year story of ongoing encounters between the author and a group of Bigfoot that played in her yard and walked by her house in the dead of the night. And it's a detailed long-term observation, providing a seldom recorded look at Bigfoot and their interactions with humans. And this is just, I mean, this is so amazing to me, Sally. Have you been back out to this area since?
No, I never have. When the book came out last October, Autumn and I went up to the Northwest Writers Convention up in Portland to launch it,
mm-hmm.
and we were supposed to have a reunion with Yodi and Janet and all the people in the book, and I got the flu, and I had to come home. But we're planning on making a trip this summer. Autumn has been back several times.
Okay. She's been back to where your cabin was?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, yeah, it's not, nothing is the same.
Oh, really? Okay. So yeah. do you believe that they're still living there, then?
I don't know.
There's been no accounts of it in the area?
You have to ask Autumn as far as reports sightings and stuff from that area go. She has a database on that stuff.
Okay. All right. Well, yeah, we'll definitely check in with her on that and maybe get an update on what's been going on in that area. So now, we've gone through the first couple of major events. Now, did your husband witness these things as well, or was it basically just you and Autumn that were seeing?
My husband was the biggest skeptic in the world.
Okay. So when you told him, oh, my God, honey, this is what we've seen, he thought you'd just been hitting the hookah pipe too hard or what?
I didn't even tell him.
Okay. Oh, really? You kept it to yourself?
No. Oh, no. I didn't tell him any of the stuff that was going on for a long time.
Now, let me ask, too, because, you know, we try to make sure that we ask this of all the people, especially when they make a claim, like talking about hippie times. Were there drugs involved at all? At the times that you saw these creatures, was there any chance for it being a hallucinatory effect?
No.
Okay. All right. Yeah, like I said, don't mean to be disrespectful, but I'm just trying to clarify to understand what exactly is going on. So, yeah, Tim?
I was going to say, if it wasn't a hallucinatory effect, that would have been pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it was a hallucinatory effect, but
right.
not too many of that.
You're getting high on the horrible smell. Is that what it was?
Yeah, that's it.
Huffing Bigfoot. I think that's going to be the name of my next record.
Hey, you just hold one nostril shut.
I think
I... Sally, and you can see monsters.
Dude, Sally, come on over, man. We're going to be snorting some Bigfoot dander. All right, so how many times did this happen before your husband started to take notice of it as well?
Well, he took notice of it, but in the wrong way. He avoided any talk about it, anything. He was way down on it. So until he had his own sighting.
Okay. And then how long into this living there did he have his own sighting?
Oh, gee. I don't remember the time. It was when the flood came.
Okay.
I think it must have been a little over a year, maybe into 2 years.
And what happened with his sighting?
There was the flood, and he was out checking on all the neighbors and checking the river with one of our other neighbors who lived across the river. And they looked out across the river, and here was this big root ball, and from up beside it stood this Skookum. And he couldn't even talk about it when he got home.
Wow.
The other guy had to tell me what had happened, why they'd been gone so long.
And it just stood there? Did it take off running?
No, it walked up the ridge across the river and kept looking back at them as it went.
Hmm. Now, do they move particularly fast when they walk, or just like a regular 7-foot guy's stride would be?
It depends on the circumstances.
Okay. Have you seen them really haul ass? I mean, do they ever take off where they're just there one second and gone the next?
Well, I've seen them there 1 second and gone the next.
Okay.
But they went running.
Oh, so they just vanish in front of you.
Uh-huh.
All right, so it's not like you look at him and all of a sudden you turn away and look and you hear because he's tearing off through the woods. Larry, hide! We got seen again! Now, Skookum, let's talk about that. Where did this name come from?
It's a Chinook Indian name for Bigfoot.
Okay. And did you know that at the time? Is that what you were referring to, or did you just find out about that when you wanted to put the book together?
No, it was called that during those times.
Okay, all right. So you've got him now witnessing this, and you said, was that probably a year or two into you living there, or was it within the first year of living there that he had his experience?
Oh, gee. I remembered it for the book, but I don't remember off the top of my head. It was, I think it was It was just before Christmas, but I don't remember which Christmas.
Well, wasn't that driving you mad at that point, that you were seeing and hearing things and you couldn't really share it with your husband, and being kind of isolated the way you were? I would think that would just be unbearable to kind of hold into your own world.
I had my friend Yodi, who lived who came out to her cabin next door.
Okay, so
I could talk to her about it.
All right, well,
I could never talk to my husband about any of that kind of stuff.
Hmm. Now, that brings up a good point, other kind of stuff. Aside from Bigfoot sightings, were any other strange paranormal things going on in that area? Why don't you tell us a little bit about that? What kind of things were you experiencing with that as well?
Well, when there was lights up above the ridge across the river,
mm-hmm.
there was a great big light that would come, and then it was like half the size of the moon up there, only brighter even, and it was white. And then these other lights would come off the ridge and kind of be absorbed into the bottom of it,
mm-hmm.
different colored lights. And Yodi and I got to looking into stuff around there. I read an old Frank Edwards book
mm-hmm.
about UFO stuff.
Okay.
And I found where one had run into a C-118. I don't know if that's right or not, but that's what it said in the book.
Okay.
And it was an Air Force plane.
Sure.
And it had something to do with orange balls that crashed into the plane, or the plane crashed into them, and all the guys on it were killed.
Hmm.
And so we started looking into that. And while we were looking into that, we found out that a huge meteor had crashed up on the same ridge in the 50s. Both of these events took place in the 50s.
Okay.
And so we started looking into all of that. We researched back into the old papers at the Orting newspaper. And the only times that were missing in like 100 years were the times of that crash. Plane crash.
Little government cover-up again, huh?
Seems so, huh?
Now, do you feel, some people believe that there's a definite correlation between UFO activity and Bigfoot. Do you believe that the Skookum might be aliens?
I don't know what they are. All I know is that all of this stuff happened in the same place and during the same time period. Other than that, I don't know if they're connected.
Just might be like a nexus, a certain area where just the paranormal comes together, huh?
Uh-huh.
Strange. All right, so you've had UFO experiences. Do you believe, aside from the Skookum, that you've seen any other alien-type creatures?
No.
No?
I don't know that the Skookum was either, but...
Sure. Well, but I'm saying, I meant other than the Skookum, did you see any other strange creatures?
No.
Okay. And now, how did you have animals? I know you said the neighbors did have a lot of dogs and such in the area. Would they react wildly to when these things were in the area?
Oh, yeah.
What kind of, just barking and hysterics?
The lady down the road,
mm-hmm.
Her name was Esther. She had this dog named Blackjack that was blind and deaf and stunk and had the mange and...
Perfect house pet, huh?
Oh, yeah.
Cute little puppy.
Aw, look at you. Come here, boy. Come, who's daddy's cute little...
Aren't
oh,
you
God,
cute?
That smell.
Yeah.
All right. So, and what would happen with this stinky, blind, stupid dog? How would he even know there's a Bigfoot nearby? Was it...
It smelled like him.
Yes.
Yes. Oh, she'd come down every once in a while having a fit because... All these lights were going on and screams during the night, and Blackjack, he'd go out to go to the bathroom, and he'd come in and hide under the bed and do it there instead.
Oh, jeez.
So, yeah.
Well, but he was blind. Maybe he just thought that was like a place to go.
Mm-hmm. I don't know.
All right, so you've got all this going on. You've got the animals in the area are being affected. Were the dogs ever running free? Did they ever chase these things?
I don't know. We didn't have dogs.
Okay. All right. Well, I didn't know if any of the neighbors had ever, you know, that you spoke with and that you talked about in the book, if they ever had experiences with the dogs taking off after the Skookum and trying to capture them. Or how about physical evidence? I mean, what kind of major physical evidence did you ever find? Did you find the clumps of hair Did you?
I had a clump of hair from that first day, and I don't have it anymore. I suspect that my husband ridded himself of it.
All right.
I have footprint photos that I took. We walked down to the end of the road one time. We were going to take a, Yodi and I, in autumn, we're going to take a picture of an old trestle that was down there, where the railroad used to go for the coal mines.
Sure.
And we got down onto that beach, and there was probably 50, 60 footprints.
Wow.
On the beach. Yeah, we didn't expect anything there. And I hadn't taken a picture since I was a small girl. And I thought, well, these aren't going to come out. They came out beautifully.
Amazing. Now, do you have a website set up that people can take a look at your stuff?
I have. Autumn set me up on her website.
Okay.
My address is sally@oregonbigfoot.com.
All right, and that's your email address?
Uh-huh.
And what's Sally's website? Do you know that off the top of your head? We can look that up probably during the show.
What
is Sally's website? So if people wanted, or
you mean Autumn?
Autumn's website, right? I'm sorry.
OregonBigfoot.com.
At OregonBigfoot.com. Okay, uh-huh. Yeah, we'll have people take a look at that. So it's OregonBigfoot.com, and you can look up and see the pictures and see some of the accounts there.
Well, she has she put 62 pages of my letters that I wrote the book from.
Okay.
And a whole bunch of pictures from Ording. But they're on her members section, and that's something that costs a bit a month.
Okay, yeah, but it's well worth it for people that are involved in the paranormal and would like to research.
Yeah, I think it's $4.95 a month or $5 a month.
Oh, perfect.
To be on it's the forum and the members section.
Well worth it. Well worth it, I would say, especially to see the kind of evidence and hear the first-hand accounts that you two have both, had throughout your life like this.
Yeah.
Now, were there ever a point that you were fearful of these creatures?
You know, that's funny. That after our neighbors, Emily was Yodi's daughter, and her husband and their two boys lived two cabins over. And they had a sighting one night that lasted 3 hours, about that, and there was two young ones and two adults in their yard.
Really?
And they watched them for most of one night. And after that, we had CBs hooked up. Yodi brought her CBs out. And I don't know how long it was after. Probably a week or so after they had their sighting.
Okay.
And we had the CB set up next to our bed. And Kurt, the husband there, he called on the CB about 1 o'clock in the morning one night. And he said, they're outside of our house. I can't see anything, but I can hear them, and they're stomping, and they're headed. He was just scared to death.
Wow.
When they had their sighting, it...
Now, what were they doing in the front yard? I mean, having a picnic, playing Frisbee? What were the Bigfoot? We were just walking around, scratching trees, or what?
Big Grateful Dead concert.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, the big one was out back, like he was babysitting, standing by a tree with his hand over a limb, leaning on it, and there was two little ones that were playing in her yard.
Huh.
And then there was another one later on in the thing that was picking leaves off a tree. And after this happened, Emily, before that, she was a very silent person.
Sure.
Almost invisible. It changed her personality completely.
I would guess that would bring it out in you a little bit, don't you think?
And the next morning, her and Yodi came over, and they were just, blah, 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 or she was anyway, about all this stuff, and she'd hardly ever spoken before. Hmm. Her husband, on the other hand, turned into a wimp.
Really?
It took all his juice out of him. He was sitting on the couch all covered with his shawl and drinking tea. And
So Bigfoot makes people more effeminate, is what you're saying.
No.
Okay.
Started his own knitting circle and got together with the girls every once in a while.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, so after that happened to him, Yodi set the CBs up, and he called in the middle of the night that night, and he said, they're coming toward your cabin. And he was scared to death. He was gasping, and God, that's when I got scared.
Sure.
It was contagious.
Right, right.
So that was the night that we were My husband went into the living room window where you could see the path out there, and I was sitting talking to Emily on the CB, and all of a sudden the waterbed started shaking and going in great rolls.
Hey now, Sally, come on. We don't want to hear any naughty stories here. All right, keep your stories or your waterbed to yourself. Let's just talk about Bigfoot. So you could actually feel the you could feel the thumping from your waterbed. That didn't come out right either. So you could feel it. Now what happened? So did they suddenly appear then, coming towards you? Were you able to see them?
My husband was sitting in the living room looking out the window, and he could see the path, and he could see nothing except where the footprints, where they were making footprints in the fir duff out there, and you could see the footprints being made, but there was nothing visible.
Really?
Yeah, and then we could hear them walking off towards the river in the distance. That's the night he became the believer.
Sure. See, that's why you never see Bigfoot in suburbia, Tim. Because our old neighbor, Mr. Johnson, he'd have been out there, "Hey, you big feet, get off my lawn!"
Whack, whack.
Exactly.
You know how long it's going to take those imprints to grow back out?
That's right. I can't even imagine. So that's the night that your husband flipped and turned the corner, huh? That this was it. So you could actually see the footprints. Now, I mean, that's insane. Now, what kind of noises are they making when they, "Hey, Bob, let's go down to the lake and look for some walleye." You know, or is it more of the ape-like noises that you've heard, or is it howling like dogs? What, can you explain any of it to us?
That night, there wasn't any noises.
Okay.
Other nights, there was, well, depending on the night, you could hear screams echoing back and forth through the canyon. When they were close, you could, to the window, when, you know, sleeping during late spring, summer, you have the window open.
Okay.
You could hear, like, Chinese garbling type, you know. I don't know how to explain it. It wasn't low like Japanese guttural. It was high-pitched. And there was giggling.
So Bigfoot speaks Chinese, you think?
No, that's the only thing I know to relate it to.
Okay, all right.
Sounds like Bigfoot's drinking too much sake is what it sounds like.
No, I'm sure. This is a family that ordered the hot wing. A hot wing and rice. You deliver. No, God, no, we're going to get all kinds of violent email. So you've got this going on. But the screams, I'm curious about, was it screaming like, did it sound humanistic or did it sound animal? Because I think, you know, I don't know if you've ever been woken up by the sound of cats making love.
Yeah.
You know, Tim pays a lot of money for that. But that is a horrifying noise to wake up to.
Yes, it is.
Because it's almost like a baby being slaughtered outside your window, just this horrific screaming, high-pitched noise. Could it be mountain cats mating that you were hearing? I mean, how do you know that it was coming from Bigfoot? Maybe mountain cats are quiet, Tim. I don't know. Can you look into that, Tim?
I will, yeah.
Tim, have you ever heard a cougar?
No. Have you?
I have. Uh-huh.
Yeah. I heard a John Cougar.
Oh, God.
Mellencamp.
Yes. Did they... Do they make that kind of noise? I mean, were you able to differentiate this is definitely not an animal that you've heard before?
Yes.
Okay. And was it screaming just like they were talking to one another screaming or like painful screams?
Gee. I never really thought about that. It was so loud and it had to have come from such a vast chest cavity that it echoed all the way down that canyon.
Mm.
Esther thought we were getting done in.
That is crazy. Hey, Tim, is there any possibility while we're doing this interview, can you pull up a website, see if you can find a Bigfoot scream and see if we can play it for the audience and see if maybe Sally recognizes one of her friends? that's Ben.
I was just checking on Google to see if I could find the sounds of cougars making love, and I got a message back saying, "Get a life."
Oh, excellent.
Who knew?
No, but try to look up Bigfoot for me and see if you can find. I know there's I think Texas Bigfoot has got a website, but I know there's some noises out there. I'd just like to hear and get Sally's impression if any of these sound similar to what she was dealing with. See, because that's another thing. I don't know, Sally. You're in a little shabbin out in the middle of the woods. And a shabbin is, you know, a cross between a shack and a cabin. So you're out in your little shabbin. And you're hearing screams at night, thumping outside your house. I give you a lot of credit. I can't see staying for that kind of thing. I would think just for my kids alone, I would be so afraid something strange was going to happen, I'd just have to take off and leave. And you said other neighbors were having this happen too, aside from your neighbor's husband who turned into a little old lady. Did anybody else have any strange effects because of the Bigfoot?
One of our neighbors had all his ducks killed.
Really?
Yeah, and stacked up like cordwood.
Well,
they didn't eat them.
But they just didn't like ducks. Bigfoot.
I don't know.
Bigfoot hates ducks, Tim. Now we know.
But they do offer it on the menu.
Yes, it is true.
But they do like rabbit.
Oh, really? They'll eat rabbit?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Now, would you find body parts? Or how do you know that it was Bigfoot eating rabbit, not a wolf or a coyote? Or?
Because the papers that I put them out in, the freezer paper, was unwrapped.
Oh, so there was some dexterity to it. It wasn't just shredded up and eaten right there in the paper, huh?
Well, there was not only dexterity, but the last time that they took, we put out presents for them. And the last time that they took them, they ripped the paper up into little bitty pieces and stacked it neatly.
Oh, geez. Did you hear this, Tim? The more we're learning about it, Bigfoot has OCD.
Uh-huh.
He needs to clean and stack. He speaks some form of Chinese and hates ducks.
And loves sake.
Yes, this is a very good knowledge to have. Because you know, I don't want to be dressed like a duck in the middle of the woods now, Tim, because I'm done for. And you as a rabbit were cooked. Easter must not be a good time of year for Bigfoot. That's all
so
I can
when
say.
You take your kids and run,
yeah,
you look for some guy that has his fur neatly parted down the middle.
Exactly. No, yeah. You got me wrong. I'm the guy that throws the kids at him so I can get away. I don't claim to be a brave man, Sally. Here, this one's plump. Take this one. I'm off. So.
Well, it was kind of a situation where we didn't have the money to move even if we had wanted to.
I don't know. There's, you know, wow. Did these, with all this going on, all of these experiences you're having, why do you think that they were just so free with showing themselves to you when they seemed so stealthy and easy to hide all the other times?
I think it has a lot to do with the number of women and children that were around there.
You think they just felt more secure and
mm-hmm.
open with you?
Yeah. I think they're much more prone to show themselves to women and children. I don't think that's as threatening.
Interesting.
Well, my husband kept the gun by the bed lots of times. Like when they, after he had finally figured out that, yeah, this was happening,
mm-hmm.
then we went out one day and he butchered all the rest of the rabbits we had. And the next morning he went out and the rabbit hutches were upended. Now, these were built out of 2x6 with, what do you call that stuff? Little squares, real tight little squares, the metal.
Oh, chicken wire?
No, not chicken wire. It was heavy.
Just
heavy
like
duty
a,
stuff.
Like a wire mesh kind of deal?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, these things, I don't know how much they weighed, but he said it would have taken like four of him to move it a couple feet, and it was upended and moved about 20 feet away from where it had been.
Wow.
The back of it was ripped open, the nails, 16-penny nails they were torn out with the wire.
Huh. So Bigfoot was pissed that you took away the buffet. Is that it?
I think so. I don't know.
No more for you. You've been here 4 hours, Bigfoot. You eat vegetable.
All right, well, we're going to take a quick break. You're listening to The Darkness on the Edge of Town, and sometimes I wonder why, but thank you for tuning into the show this evening. We're speaking to Sally Sheppard Wolford. She's the author of a book called Valley of the Skookum, 4 Years of Encounters with Bigfoot. We'll be back with more right after this.
Are UFOs real? Does Bigfoot exist? Was Emily Rose really possessed? Who is the next American Idol?
She bangs! She bangs! Oh, baby, when she moves, she moves.
Thank you.
We try to answer these questions and more each week on The Darkness on the Edge of Town.
To use the words of Mary Thompson, there is no greater pain than the loss of a loved one. So many things you never thought you would have to do, and so many decisions you never thought you would have to face. Mary describes the painful journey of losing her husband to a chronic illness in her new book, With Angels Beside Me, A Caregiver's Story. With Angels Beside Me not only takes you through Mary's struggles, but also serves as a guide to caregivers everywhere that are looking to find peace, guidance, and hope in their own situations. With Angels Beside Me, A Caregiver's Story is available right now at Amazon.com. Just search for the title on Amazon or for Mary herself. With Angels Beside Me is only $9.95 and available to ship anywhere around the world. If you know someone who's losing a loved one, or if you yourself are facing some sort of loss of a family member, be sure to read Mary Thompson's With Angels Beside Me, A Caregiver's Story. Available right now on Amazon.com.
George Clooney, Carmen Diaz, Oprah, Ellen, George Bush, Diane Pelosi.
What are you doing?
I'm making a list of people I want to tell about charity checks.
Do you know any of those people?
No, but if I can get to them, they might want to tell the public how cool it is to use giving certificates as presents instead of gift certificates.
Giving certificates?
Yeah, you know, they can be used as a donation to any legitimate charity. So the person who gives a charity check gets the tax deduction, and the person who gets one decides where the money goes.
Why don't you just tell people directly about charity checks yourself?
Like anyone would listen to me.
www.charitychecks.us for information about the perfect present.
Well, no, they're not going to listen to you like that. But if you just said that Charity Checks provides a unique way to turn your gift money into giving money, they might pay attention.
Catchy.
Then you just casually say the web address, charitychecks.us, America's Giving Certificate.
I still think a celebrity endorsement would be more effective.
If you read Taps Paramag every month, you'll be able to tell the difference between the absurd.
Could not go to work because Bigfoot stole my car.
And the creepy. Taps Paramag takes you where few would ever go on purpose. From exclusive interviews with the cast of The Ghost Hunters to the latest trends in technology in the field of the paranormal. To join our journey, order at tapsparamag.com.
Are you tired of reading about what couple in Hollywood is breaking up or divorcing? Have you ever wondered where you can find the news that covers the subjects that you are really interested in? I would like to invite you to visit SupernaturalNews.com. Supernatural News uses the latest internet technology to search for the topics we know you will be interested in reading. News of the latest Bigfoot, UFO, or Loch Ness Monster sightings. Read about the latest conspiracy theories and urban legends. Supernatural News, where belief and reality merge.
Do you hear loud moans and banging on your walls? Next time, pay for the better hotel room.
Oh, no more Yankee, my Winky. The donga needs food.
Welcome back to the darkness on the edge of town with your hosts, Dave Schrader and Tim Dennis.
Good evening and welcome back to the show. You're listening to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. I'm your host, Dave Schrader, along with me as always, Timmy D, sitting across the board. And our guest this evening is Sally Sheppard Wolford. She wrote a book called Valley of the Skookum. She's actually written a number of children's books as well, one about Bigfoot. But this book she wrote kind of as a nice little account and almost a diary for her daughter to reflect on what happened from the time her daughter Autumn was 4 to the age of 7 when they were going through all of these crazy experiences with Bigfoot. So you're out there, you're living now. Again, this is in Ording, Washington, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You're living in a shabbin. You've got these things coming all around you. You've had a couple of moments of fear with them. You've seen footprints appear in front of your eyes without them being there. You've seen UFOs in the sky. How does this affect the rest of your life, Sally? I mean, once you've seen these things and you've experienced this, how does that play into your everyday life?
You don't have any doubt anymore.
Right. Right. But I mean, do you get there and feel that, you know, I mean, to me, when I had my UFO experience and my alien experience, it plagued me. It still does. I want to see again. I want to go back out. I mean, do you have these overwhelming urges and cravings to see again, to experience this again?
For all those years, I put it in a little locked box in my mind, and I had no desire whatsoever to even go back there to deal with Autumn with it. Now, yes. The barriers have come down. And it's funny, when you have this stuff going on for so many days, so many months, years at a time, it almost becomes normal.
Well, yeah, I guess so. After a while, it just...
Yeah, it's like, well, it's not if something's going to happen next, it's when it's going to happen next.
Right. Yeah, see, what a crazy, I mean, amazing life, but it's just so crazy that that would be going on, and,
yeah.
You know, people just living it like it's normal. I mean, that's something I'd love to have experienced. Tim, I don't know about you. We've talked about UFOs and ghosts and things like that, and I don't even think I've ever brought it up on the show. Tim, do you have any belief in Bigfoot? I mean, is that something that you think could be out there?
Possibly, but you know, the thing that interests me, Sally, is now that you kind of expounding on what Dave asked, and I take it you're still not living in Orting, Washington, correct?
No.
Okay. So, in your in the town you live in now, do you find yourself looking for these things now that you've seen them?
Well, Autumn and I went through her database of sightings and stuff, and there's only been 3 sightings here ever. And where we live, it's on a river again. And just up over the hill, there's 30 miles of nothing, which is very odd to me.
But you think that... Well, I mean, it sounds like a perfect place for them to live, then, if there's all that emptiness.
It does.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Huh.
But well, I know all of this. One thing I know, one thing I ask myself is, why this happened to us? Well, you know, we never realized any conclusion to it. When we moved, I had more questions than answers. And the only thing that I can see that came out of this is my daughter. It set the course for the whole rest of her life.
Sure. Sure, well, that's pretty impressive in itself that it set that up. But I would think that you would just be wanting to get back out there and see this stuff. But I guess, again, you kind of been there, done that. You spent 3 to 4 years with these creatures. You probably... You know,
well, my interest in it is quite fired up again now.
It is good. So
once that barrier came down, and I started talking to Autumn about it, and I wrote the book for her, I had to go back there and revisit all of this in great detail.
How do you figure how many Bigfoot live there? Was it just one little family pod of 4 that you kept running into? Was it, you know, Uncle Larry and Cousin Evelyn would stop by too, or
Harry.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know. I don't know how many there are. I just know there's, you know, some people say, oh, you saw Bigfoot. Like, there's one.
Okay.
There's not one. There's populations. And since Autumn did the Mysterious Encounters show a couple years ago, they
right.
kind of around the country following up on sightings people have had, and I never realized that there was that many all over the place. In every state except Hawaii, there's been sightings.
Really?
Yes.
Well, I guess Hawaii is so far out there that how would they get to the island?
Swim.
Yeah. And unless they have a waist, they couldn't hold those grass skirts up, huh?
Exactly. Although they would look cute with the 2 coconut shells in strategic
Wouldn't
places.
They?
Yes. You both need help. You know that, don't you? So, Alaska's seen them. The Yeti more, right? Sasquatch, Bigfoot, up that area. I related in a past episode when I was talking to Autumn. I saw something. I don't know exactly what I saw, but I saw something in the woods by my grandparents' pond. But to me, it was more like a gray and black looking creature. Were the colors different on these characters? Were they all like a brown or a form of, you know, brown, light browns, blondish, you know, frosted, highlighted tips? I don't know. What colors were you seeing with these guys?
The big one that we saw back in the woods was a dark brown.
All right.
And the littler one was a lot lighter.
Right, but with all the ones that you saw, because you said that there were 2 little ones, right, and at least 2 adults that you saw?
No, I didn't see them. My neighbor did.
Oh, your neighbor did. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So the whole time you were there, the most you ever saw at any one time were 2.
Right.
1 big, 1 small.
Mm-hmm.
Did they leave any other, you know, clues around your house? I mean, did you ever wake up and find, you know, big footprints right outside your window peeking in at you?
Mm-mm.
No.
You know, the funny thing is I've been in contact with other long-term witnesses since my book came out. They've contacted me, which is why I let the book be published, because I was hoping that would happen.
Sure.
And lots of them that I've heard of, they exchange presents, and we didn't have that there. The only thing I can relate to that would be a gift back to me or to us would be that paper that they tore up, you know, and stacked in little things.
Sure.
Like they were trying to tell us that we were dealing with something that was a lot more intelligent than most people think.
Well, as our first guest was talking, you know, his belief is that this is a Gigantopithecus, but I can't even say this. Right. Mm-hmm. I mean, is that what you believe you're dealing with? Is it just a giant form of great ape that's able to hide and sustain itself here in the wilderness?
I don't know. I don't think it's an ape. I think it's a lot more intelligent than that.
Really? Okay. But they've all, I mean, you've had up close personal looks at them. Do they appear to just be like, I mean, could it almost be just like a human in a like gorilla style costume? I mean, I know it's not that, but I mean, is that the kind of look it has? Or does it just look like a big dirty hippie? I mean, what, you know, help us understand exactly. Is the hair cover the entire face? Is the face free of hair like a gorilla?
There were some places where there was no hair on the face.
Okay.
You could see skin, but they were back in the shadows, so it was kind of hard to tell. They didn't have black skin like a gorilla.
Sure.
So, and they didn't look like a monkey.
Right.
It looked like a big, dirty hippie. I'm sorry.
You big, dirty hippies.
It looked human.
Okay. Well, that's interesting to me. Well, I hope that we can have an experience like this, and I'd love to keep in touch with you. And if, as our travels go, if I find anything, we'll get back to you on that. And, you know, I appreciate you spending some time here with us this evening, Sally, and sharing your experiences in your book. It's an amazing book. I highly recommend picking it up. Of course, we have a link for it on our website. It's Valley of the Skookum, and that's Skookum, 4 Years of Encounters with Bigfoot by Sally, Sally Sheppard, Sheppard, Wolford, Wolford, with a foreword by your daughter, Autumn Williams, as well. So check out the information, and again, you can also check out Oregon Bigfoot, correct?
Yes, and the book is available if anyone is interested in an autographed copy. There's a form on Autumn's website.
Great.
It's also on Amazon.
Well, we appreciate that, and thank you again for sharing your time with us, for sharing your amazing stories and recollections of Bigfoot. This is something I think a lot of people around the world are insanely jealous of, that you've had that kind of experiences and that kind of continued success with seeing one of the most notoriously stealthy creatures in the world. So, you know, again, Sally, if you and Autumn see anything new or big and there's any new good news coming out, please let us know.
Thank you, Dave.
Thank you very much, Sally. And thank you, everybody, for tuning into the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. Hope you had a good time with us this evening, and we will be back next week with a brand new show. So stay tuned. We'll talk to you then.